When you're learning to use microcontrollers, some of the most powerful functions available to you are... Excuse me. Hello? When you're learning to use microcontrollers, some of the most powerful functions available to you are interrupts that... What? Okay, we're all pretty familiar with the idea of an interrupt. You might be working on your own thing, something outside of your control happens, and you have to stop whatever it is you were doing to handle that event. For example, I might be explaining a concept when I hear my phone ring. So I take that call, I put my phone away, and I go back to whatever it was I was talking about. Let's see how this relates to microcontrollers. When we write code for many basic microcontrollers, like our Arduino, we use a programming scheme known as a super loop. Here, we run a section of code once in order to configure any pins, serial ports, global variables, etc. The program then enters into a while loop that runs forever, known as a super loop. If you're programming something on a computer, having an endless loop is usually considered bad practice, but on a microcontroller, it's pretty normal. In a basic super loop structure, we might check to see if a button is pressed each time through the loop. This is known as polling, as we poll or check to see if our event has occurred. If the button has been pressed, then we can perform some action, such as toggling an LED in this case. Once the event has been checked and handled as necessary, the processor is free to perform other actions. Polling is pretty simple to do, and often it's all you'll need for most projects. However, you might run into problems if that other stuff portion takes up more than a few milliseconds, and you need to respond to button pushes right away. Asking a user to hold down a button for a few seconds is not great interface design. To solve this, we can use interrupts. Somewhere in our code, like during setup, we can tell the processor that we're open to interrupts. From then on, or at least until we disable interrupts, whenever a button push is detected, the program stops whatever it was doing and handles the interrupt. Usually, we need to tell the microcontroller how to handle the interrupt, and we do this by writing a special function known as an interrupt service routine, or ISR. In this case, the ISR will simply toggle an LED whenever a button is pressed. Notice that in our main loop, we no longer need to worry about checking the state of the button, as we've told the processor what interrupt to look for and what to do when one occurs. Note that we're not asking the microcontroller to do two things at the same time. When an interrupt occurs, the microcontroller stops, saves any bits of information it might need to memory, goes and handles the interrupt, restores that information, and then continues whatever it was working on. When working with microcontrollers, there are two types of interrupts, internal and external. Internal interrupts refer to anything that can happen inside the microcontroller to trigger an interrupt. For example, we might set up a timer to fire an interrupt every 10 milliseconds. Then, there are external interrupts. These are caused by things outside of, but connected to the microcontroller, like a button. In the rest of this episode, I'm going to show you how to take an Arduino program that polls for a button push, change it into an external interrupt handler using Arduino code, and then convert that into code that manually reads and writes registers so you can see what's really going on. As one commenter put it, I'm going to show you how to level down your Arduino code. We're going to use the exact same circuit as last time, an LED with a 330 ohm limiting resistor connected to pin 5 and a button connected to pin 2. We're going to start with a simple polling example. Here, we've defined the button and LED pins as 2 and 5. If you're not familiar with the UINT8T data type, it stands for unsigned integer 8 bits. It's great for storing small, positive numbers, and it works the same as the Arduino byte data type. However, if you plan to work in platforms other than Arduino, byte generally isn't defined, so you'll see a lot of these fixed-width data types, which help save space and memory. We then need a couple of global variables to help us remember the states of the LED and button between loop iterations. In setup, we're using an internal pull-up resistor on the button and setting the LED as an output. In order to detect a button push, we read the state of the button and see if it has gone from high to low since the previous iteration. In other words, we're looking for a falling edge on the pin connected to the button. If that falling edge is detected, change the state of the LED from low to high, or vice versa. Save the state of the button for the next loop through the iteration and add some obnoxiously long delay to pretend the processor is off doing other things. If we run this, we see that we can turn the LED on and off by pressing the button. However, notice that you have to hold down the button for a while in order to let the loop finish that long delay before pulling again. This would definitely annoy most users. Let's pretend that we can't do anything about that long delay. The processor is off performing some complex calculation that takes half a second. We can, however, interrupt that process in order to handle a button push at any time. If we look at the ATmega328P datasheet, we can go to the interrupts section. At the top of that section is the interrupt vectors table. This tells us what things can create an interrupt in the processor. Also note that this table actually exists in the program memory of the microcontroller starting at address 0. If we were writing assembly, we would have to fill out this table to tell the processor where to jump when a specific interrupt occurs. We're only concerned with external interrupts right now, so we need to look at int 0 and int 1 as the sources for these interrupts. Go to the pin configurations section. If you remember from the last episode, pin 2 on the Arduino is connected to port D pin 2. As you can see here, PD2 is tied to int 0. That means we can't make other pins be external interrupt 0. Only PD2 can trigger the int 0 interrupt. Back to the interrupt vectors table, we see that if PD2 triggers an interrupt, execution of the program will stop and jump to address 2, as the source of the interrupt was int 0. The next instruction would be a jump to somewhere else in the program memory. Ideally, this would be the beginning of our interrupt service routine. Let's take a look at a theoretical example. At the top of our program memory is the interrupt vector table. Below that is where our program lives, and at the bottom is the Arduino bootloader. When your program runs, the processor begins executing instructions sequentially in your program space. Let's say an external interrupt on port D pin 2 occurs, which is int 0. Program execution stops whatever it was doing and jumps to the int 0 interrupt vector. An interrupt vector is the memory location where an interrupt service routine can be found. In the case of our 328P, this is just another jump command to somewhere else in program memory. The interrupt service routine is a function we write in code. Once that routine has been completed, execution jumps back to where we left off in our normal program, and things just continue running. If we go to the Arduino reference guide, we see that there is a handy little function called attachInterrupt. Note that this function only works with external interrupts on pins 2 and 3 with the UNO, which correspond to the int 0 and int 1 sources we saw in the datasheet. To use it, we tell the function which interrupt source we want to use, which will be int 0 for us, the name of the function to use as the interrupt service routine, and whether we want the interrupt to trigger on a pin change, falling edge, rising edge, low, or high state. There's also a nifty function called digital pin to interrupt, which we can give it a pin number and it'll return the correct interrupt source for us. To use this function in Arduino, write attach interrupt, open parentheses, digital pin to interrupt, open parentheses, button pin, close parentheses, comma toggle, comma falling in all capital letters, close parentheses. Do this in setup under our pin mode calls. Notice that we're giving button pin, which is pin 2, to the digital pin to interrupt function, which returns the int 0 number for us. We're saying that we want the function toggle to be used as the interrupt service routine, and that we want toggle to be called whenever there's a falling edge on pin 2. Delete everything in loop, but leave the delay 500. We want this to simulate the processor doing something intensive for half a second. Underneath loop, write void toggle, open parentheses, close parentheses, open curly brace. LED state equals exclamation point LED state. Digital write, open parentheses, LED pin, comma, LED state, close parentheses, and then under that, close curly brace. When the int 0 interrupt occurs, this function is called, which switches the LED state from 0 to 1, or from 1 to 0, and then writes it to pin 5. You can also delete the button pre variable declaration since we don't need it anymore. When you run this code, you can see that the LED changes when you press the button, just like before. However, you don't have to hold it down for long periods of time anymore. Arduino is awesome in that it gives you an easy way to set up interrupts, but note that it's really only good for external interrupts. To set up internal interrupts, you're pretty much on your own. To see how to manually set up an interrupt, let's dig deeper. Since we learned how to manually control registers on the last episode, let's replace these pin mode and digital write functions. In setup, remove the pin mode functions. We can write DDRD ampersand equals tilde, open parentheses, 1 less than button pin, close parentheses, to to clear bit 2 in the data direction register for port D. Note that the ampersand equals operator has the effect of reading the value from DDRD, performing the bit clearing operation, and then writing that value back to register DDRD. We then write port D vertical bar equals open parentheses 1 less than button pin close parentheses to set bit 2 in the port D register, which has the effect of enabling the internal pull-up resistor. Below that, write DDRD vertical bar equals open parentheses 1 less than LED pin close parentheses to set bit 5 in DDRD, which turns port D pin 5 into an output. Finally, in the toggle function, remove the two lines and replace them with port D caret equals open parentheses 1 less than LED pin close parentheses. This reads the value from port D, flips bit 5, and writes it back to port D. You can also remove the LED state global variable since we don't need it anymore. We can flip an individual bit by performing the exclusive OR operation with the number 1. We left shift 1 over 5 times to get 0010000. We then read in the value of port D, which will give it some arbitrary value, like 10101100. We then perform a bitwise exclusive OR on these numbers. 0x or 1 is 1, 0x or 0 is 0, 1x or 1 is 0, and so on. Here, we can see that all the bits remain the same except for bit 5, which we flipped from 1 to 0. Had bit 5 been 0, 1x or 0 is 1, so we would still flip that bit. By flipping bit 5 from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, we can toggle the LED in one line of code, and if we run our code, we see that it works the same as before. Now comes the fun part, figuring out how to set up an interrupt by manually writing to registers. For an interrupt to trigger, three conditions must be met. First, global interrupts must be enabled. Arduino automatically enables global interrupts for us, but if you're not working in Arduino, you will have to perform this step manually. Second, the individual interrupt must be enabled, and this is usually accomplished by setting a bit in a register somewhere. And finally, third, we need to actually meet the trigger condition for that interrupt. And in our case, this is a falling edge on a pin, so the pin goes from logic high to logic low. Let's look at that datasheet again. Underneath the interrupts section, we find a section devoted to external interrupts. That looks promising. When you're trying to figure out how to set up an interrupt on a new architecture, it can be helpful to read through these interrupt sections a few times. Scroll down to the register descriptions. Here, it tells us that the lowest two bits in the external interrupt control register A allows us to set the trigger condition for int 0. Note that this register is abbreviated EICRA. We'll need that later in our code. Take a look at the interrupt sense control 0 table. We want to trigger on a falling edge, so we'll need to write binary 10 to the last two bits. Note that these bits also have names, ISC01 and ISC00. We'll be able to use those names in our code. Keep scrolling down to the external interrupt mask register, also known as EIMSK, which has only two usable bits. These are our interrupt enable bits for the external interrupts. So we'll want to set bit 0 in order to tell the processor that we want to allow interrupts to trigger for int 0. We don't need to worry about the other registers in this section, as we've already set up the trigger condition and enabled the individual interrupt. We just need to find where to enable global interrupts. If you read the description for int 0 in the EIMSK register, you'll see that we also need to set the I bit in the status register, which is abbreviated SREG. If you start searching for SREG, you'll find that it's described in the AVR CPU core section under status register. Here, we see that the I bit is bit 7 in the SREG, and that's what allows us to control global interrupts. If you read this part, you'll see that we can set and clear this bit with the SEI and CLI commands, which have been implemented in C for us by the AVR framework. Get rid of the attachInterrupt call and write EICRA vertical bar equals open parentheses 1 less than ISC01 close parentheses. This sets bit 1 in the external interrupt control register A. Notice that we're able to call both the register and bit by name here thanks to some header files in the AVR libraries. Under that, write EICRA ampersand equals tilde open parentheses 1 less than ISC00 close parentheses to clear bit 0. Now, the lowest two bits in EICRA are set to 10, which means that the int 0 interrupt will trigger on a falling edge. Then, write EIMSK vertical bar equals open parentheses 1 less than less than int 0 close parentheses to set the int 0 bit in the external interrupt mask register, which enables interrupts for the int 0 source. Finally, write SEI open parentheses close parentheses, which has the effect of setting the I bit in SREG to enable global interrupts. Note that while Arduino turns on global interrupts by default, it's helpful to see here what you would need to do if you weren't using Arduino. If you want to turn off interrupts, you could write CLI, but we don't need to do that for this example. Finally, we're not calling the toggle function directly anymore, so we need to set up a block of code that gets run from the int 0 interrupt vector. AVR has a special function called ISR that tells the compiler we're making an interrupt service routine. We need to supply this function with the name of our interrupt vector, which is based on the interrupt vector names in the datasheet. Change void toggle to ISR in all capital letters, open parentheses, int 0 in capital letters, underscore vect, close parentheses, open curly brace. This tells the compiler that this is the service routine that should be run whenever an int 0 interrupt occurs. Upload this code. As before, you should see the LED toggle when you press the button. Now that you've seen how to set up interrupts, I want to cover two more very important concepts. The first is that you should always keep your service routines as short as possible. By default in AVR, you can't interrupt an interrupt, and you usually want to get back to your main program as quickly as possible. If you're finding that the ISR takes too much of your program time, you can always handle interrupts with a flag. That means setting a global variable and changing it in the interrupt. Somewhere in your loop, you can check that flag, execute whatever you need to do, and then reset the flag. This is similar to polling, but has the benefit of not missing the interrupt. The second lesson is that if you use a global variable in your main program and in an interrupt, like our flag here, you should always declare it as a volatile variable. This tells the compiler that the variable might change outside the main execution thread, which it does in the ISR. Many times, compilers will be set to optimize away variables like this. It sees that we set the flag to 0 and assumes that it'll never change again because the compiler doesn't see it changing in the ISR. So it'll assume the if statement is always false and remove that chunk of code. By declaring the flag variable as volatile, we're telling the compiler that it should not optimize out parts of our code with that variable. When you run this, you'll see that you can still toggle the LED, but it might take up to half a second to respond. The good news is that you still don't have to hold down the button to make it happen. Interrupts open a new way to respond to events outside the control of your main program loop. They can definitely get complicated pretty quickly, but they do offer more precise response times when you need them. There are many different types of interrupts available, and we just looked at one. Next time, we'll look at how to set up timer interrupts. If you want to stay up to date with more videos like this one from SparkFun, make sure you subscribe to our channel. And happy hacking! Arduino, whatever it is, example. These are int 0 number frames. Oh, I guess you heard that one. LED state equals, what is that called, an exclamation point. This is like a tongue twister. What did I write?